how to respond to IMO GHG issues. This presentation will cover EEXI, CII, and all relevant GHG issues, and detailed presentations will be followed for each subject. Now let's start with reviewing IMO's GHG regulations. The ultimate goal of IMO is very clear, and that it is to reach 100% decarbonization of the shipping industry as quickly as possible, and certainly by the end of the century. To set out on this path, IMO has established two intermediate targets. The first is to reduce carbon intensity by 40% by 2030 from a 2008 baseline, and by 70% by 2050 for individual vessels. The second target is for a total reduction in GHG emissions by 50% from the shipping industry by 2050, also compared with a 2008 baseline. When put in the context of the continued growth of the world fleet, it seems that achieving the second target will be more challenging than the first. To achieve these intermediate targets, IMO has developed short-term, mid-term, and long-term measures. For the short-term, IMO has developed technical and operational energy efficiency measures, both for new and existing ships. These are EEDI, EEXI, and CII. Please note that EEXI and CII will be adopted in 2023, and there won't be any delay. As far as we understand, these measures will be implemented and shipping companies will have to comply. For those that don't, it is likely that penalties will be applied. In the same way, incentives will be given to high-efficiency vessels. This means that it will be the energy-efficient shipping companies that will survive into the future. And so the development and adoption of eco-technology is essential. Why is IMO developing EEXI for existing ships? Currently, new build vessels must comply with EEDI, which means they must reduce speed and implement low carbon fuel systems or energy saving devices to reduce their GHG emissions. However, existing ships are not subject to the same restrictions. This is significant when we consider that 70% of the current fleet does not need to comply with EEDI. EEXI is being implemented to rebalance the fleet and to reduce overall GHG emissions. EEDI regulation for new build vessels were brought into force from Phase 0 in 2013, reduction rate 0%, and Phase 3 will start 2025, reduction rate 30%. EEXI will start from 2023, and reduction rate is set up between Phase 2 and Phase 3, or 20% to 30%. For pre-EEDI ships, the gap of reduction rate to target EEXI is 20 to 30% plus ALPA. For EEDI Phase 0 ship, the gap of reduction rate is within 20 to 30%, and most of Phase 2 or 3 ships satisfy EEXI and no problem. In conclusion, we can expect most of pre-EEDI ships don't satisfy EEXI and need much improvement of energy efficiency. Even some EEDI ships also don't satisfy EEXI and need improvement of energy efficiency, but not so critical. The results will be shown later on. EEXI is technical measure, or it means the ship should have to have good energy performance technically. However, IMO is going a step further and requires the ship's actual GHG emissions to be evaluated by means of CII, Carbon Intensity Indicator Rating. CII is calculated based on IMO DCS data, or actual fuel consumption over the previous year. Each vessel will then be rated A, B, C, D, and E. The actual fuel consumption will depend on the ship's technical performance and how it is operated. Corrective action is needed for ships rated as D for 3 consecutive years, rated as E for just one time. The chart shows that the required CII is getting lower and lower every year. Therefore, if a conventional ship began with a C rating, the same vessel is likely to be ranked with a D rating after a number of years if no additional efficiency improvements have been made. Reducing speed is most likely means to maintaining the rating. However, LNG-fueled ships with good energy efficiency and starting out with an A rating will take many years for the rating to be eroded to B or C. It is unlikely that these vessels will need to reduce their speed to maintain their rating, which is good for their business. Let's move on to discuss how to comply with EEXI. KR has already calculated EEXI for about 1,700 ships. On the chart, we've plotted tankers on the left and bulk carriers on the right. You can see most pre-EEDI ships do not satisfy EEXI. Even for EEDI applied bulk carriers, we can see that 30% do not satisfy EEXI. This means that, in total, around 80% of these vessels will need additional measures to improve their energy efficiency. With EEXI expected to come into force in 2023, ship owners should be taking action now. Bottlenecks can be expected. Detailed results, including speed reduction for each ship type, will be presented by another presentation. EEXI calculation. At KR, we have developed EEXI and CII guidelines for our customers. If your vessel cannot comply with EEXI, the first step is power limitation using EPL, engine power limitation, or SHPALI, shaft power limitation. Consequently, speed should be reduced. This measure is quick and cheap to implement, and also easy to verify compared with other measures. If you decide that operating at a reduced speed doesn't interfere with your business, then an International Energy Efficiency Certificate, IEEC, will be issued. However, if the reduced speed negatively impacts on your business, then you will need to implement a range of energy-saving devices, ESDs. Other options are selling or replacing the vessel with a new build or changing your chartering arrangements. Even if reducing speed is accepted, you should thoroughly evaluate its cost effectiveness. Only if cost effective should you consider a combination of EPL and ESD. Before deciding on power limitation, you should understand how much impact it might have on the vessel's operation or your business. This slide shows a speed power curve based on a ship's operating profile. The black line is the sea trial result. If power limitation is 20% of MCR, for example, the impact would be small, just 2 or 3%. However, if power limitation is 30%, then the ship's operation would be much more limited, and you should re-evaluate and perhaps find an alternative solution. Good decision-making will rely on good data. This slide shows a range of energy devices designed to improve a ship's speed or to minimize power limitation. Let us now look at the options an owner might choose. Of course, EPL, or engine power limitation, is the cheapest and fastest method. Another option is EPL with ESD. Is LNG dual fuel an option? This depends on the remaining life of a vessel, as it costs around $10 million to retrofit, more than twice as much as a new build. This option only makes sense if the ship has many years left to operate. A cost-benefit analysis must be carried out. A new build to replace a low-energy ship is also an option. If the speed of an existing ship has been reduced to comply with EEXI, but it is slow, that is impacting on its ability to achieve charters, then a replacement might be needed. This slide shows the factors that should be considered to find a cost-effective solution. CapEx, OpEx, remain service life, time for engineering and installation, and verification of ESDs, chartering speed, CII for lifetime, retrofit versus new build. Doing this will result in an individual solution for each vessel and each owner. As a starting point, it is important to understand the index of your ships. To help with this, KR has developed its EEXI CII software, and these will be provided free of charge. KR also has developed software to allow you to identify the optimum combination of ESD and EPL. Additionally, KR has also developed a CFD, Computational Fluid Dynamics, verification procedure for ESD. Now, let's move on to discuss how to keep high CII rate. We've carried out CII calculations for about 900 ships, and the results have been quite remarkable. We found that around 50% of vessels were ranked as D or E, where corrective action is necessary. If we also believe that vessels rated as C are vulnerable to be re-rated to D, then there are a total of 80% that might require additional measures. We believe only 20% of vessels are ranked A or B, and it is these ships that will be incentivized by the charters and the banks. To improve CII, systematic maintenance for hull, propeller, and engine are necessary. In addition, your vessel must be operated as efficiently as possible. Owners should develop a life cycle management plan based on CII optimization. KR has MOUs in place with HHI Group, SHI, and DSME for EEXI and CII improvement. This includes cost evaluation of retrofit versus new build and further development of a zero-carbon ship. We will happily share the outcomes with our customers when we can. Now, let's move on to discuss mid, long-term GHG responses. This chart is from Clarksons and shows how the use of marine fuel is expected to reduce over time. Fuel oil is shown in red, LNG in dark blue, and the sky blue is for zero carbon fuels such as ammonia and hydrogen. If a ship is built in 2035, and assuming a ship's life to be 20 years, the ship need to comply with IMO 2050 regulations for its last 5 years of operation. Therefore, we can expect to see zero carbon ships being built from 2030 onwards. Therefore, zero carbon ship technology should be in development right now. The first movers are likely to be the most successful. Through market-based measures or emissions trading schemes, those companies with lower GHG emissions will be incentivized, and those with high emissions will need to pay to meet the reduction targets. Those companies which operate good energy-efficient vessels will get incentives from financial circles or the cargo owner through Poseidon Principles and Right Ship. Global corporates such as Google or Apple belong to RE100 Club and have declared that their future energy usage will be from 100% renewable sources. This commitment is not only for themselves, but also for their subcontractors. In addition, shipping companies such as Maersk and CMA CGM have said that they will achieve carbon neutrality by 2050 and not 2100. How will these environmental issues impact shipyards and vendors? Traditionally, shipyards will build and deliver a good quality ship to the owner, but that's no longer good enough. Yards and vendors must now deliver a life cycle management plan. This must include data collection, evaluation, optimum maintenance, and operational measures to identify and minimize GHG emissions. Demand for new builds will increase. Because passage speed will reduce further to improve efficiency, it is likely that there will be a need to increase global capacity by 3 to 5% to compensate. Additionally, vessel size will increase. Low energy vessels will be scrapped. More LNG fueled vessels will be built to maintain a high CII rating and to be ready to switch to ammonia. Low carbon or zero carbon ships will replace conventional ships by 2050. As long as current IMO GHG regulations are enforced. The winner will take everything. The winner means here who have solutions for GHG issues. Now, we will briefly show KR's various activities for decarbonization. KR is working together with customers to procure technology regarding carbon neutral fuels like biofuel and synthetic fuel. For supporting the commercial adoption of ammonia as ship fuel, we've submitted several technical documents to the IMO and published technical reports to provide essential information for industry stakeholders. Recently, we are speeding up our efforts so that our class rules for ammonia-fueled ships come out this year. AIPs were also presented to ammonia bunkering vessels by us, and projects for developing ammonia engines with engine makers are also underway. KR is working hard for ensuring the safety of hydrogen propulsion ships and liquefied hydrogen carriers on various areas, including storage, bunkering, and cargo handling. And we are also taking part in projects, not only for developing of CO2 capture, storage, and discharge system, but also electric propulsion system for ships with eco-friendly power sources like batteries and fuel cells. KR's infrastructure for testing eco-friendly technologies is also very excellent. We are currently operating 3 cutting-edge laboratories, including a specialized test basin for engine and post-treatment, such as scrubber, SCR, carbon capture system, and one for electric propulsion tests, and an LNG bunkering simulation center. These R&D centers fostering KR's leadership in test technology and helps accelerating decarbonization. Thank you for watching our video. And if there are more needs for our technical service and information, contact our experts for further support.